teach us beyond natural understanding. Father, that you empower us beyond natural powers. Enable us, Lord, beyond natural enablement. Open up our spirit. Let this word that we are going to be sharing for the next 3 weeks, let it be such that will transform many lives. Let it be such that is going to empower us indeed. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Let's go, Holy Spirit. Please put your hands together for the Lord. And you may take your seat. Somebody say with me, He lives in me. Making the most of me through His word. I am changing into what He wants me to be. From glory to glory. His word that I'm about to hear will once again reveal His thought for me. I receive the word with joy and gladness. The order of my life is glory. Hallelujah. I start a series today for the next 3 Wednesdays. Thank you, sir. For the next 3 Wednesdays that I've titled Economic Empowerment. Economic Empowerment. Somebody tell me economic empowerment. That is spotting the opportunity for prosperity. I want you to subtitle it, Spotting the Opportunity for Prosperity. Spotting opportunity Somebody say with me, prosperity is everywhere. It is possible to prosper. You can prosper. And our text for this teaching series is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verse 18. Media team, can you bring that up, please? Deuteronomy 8, 18, media team, I hope. The issue of the what we need to be able to have the words and the pictures at the same time is already it is working. Hallelujah. Let's read that together. He said, and you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He who giveth you power to get wealth. Hold on again. He said, you will remember the Lord your God. In other words, the identification with God is a remembrance for getting power. This word could be to those who know God and those who don't know Him. In other words, if I am to preach God to anybody anywhere in the world, one of the things that I can say to them, especially the wealthy, I can say to a wealthy man, this scripture, that you will remember the Lord your God, that you will remember your Maker, because all you have, you might think you got it by your power. But it is He that giveth thee what? Power to get wealth. That He may establish His covenant which He swore to your fathers as it is these days. First of all, understanding that the power to get wealth is available. It is not only up to God for your prosperity. The people He was speaking with here are not just poor people. They have already gotten the wealth. So He's telling them to remember the Lord, because God gives you power to get wealth. Is somebody getting this now? In other words, if those who got the wealth, if it is God who enables them to get the wealth, then the question then could be more like the brother of the prodigal. You remember the story of the prodigal son? Through the prodigal son, went to his father and said, Father, give me all that is mine right now. And the Bible said the father wanted to show him or what to teach him lesson. He released unto him all that is his. And this guy got everything that is his. And he went away and he squandered all. Everything he squandered. He not only squandered it, he had no interest left. He had nothing left that he could tap from, that he could use for the benefit of himself. To the point that he not only reached rock bottom, he was in the pit. eating with the pigs. Many of us have squandered opportunity. Many of us have squandered relationships. Many of us have squandered money. And many of us, oftentimes, we have squandered the time. When you look at your age, some of us listening to me right now, you probably have squandered the first 20 years of your life. Some are in their 30s, maybe you have squandered the first 30 of your life. Maybe you are in your 40s, you have squandered, if you have squandered the first 40 of your life. And if it's beyond that, I want you to begin to ask questions. The time that God has given to you is resources and money that God has given to you. Time is of essence. Time is investment. What you do with your time determines who you become. What you do with your time depending on the way your life will go. Somebody have decided to listen to this series or to come, or you are part of this, or you are watching from the internet and you are glued to it because you want to learn something. You're probably going to get something, or you are definitely going to get something that will transform your life forever. It might be just a little information. It might just be just a little nut, and somebody might just take that and say, you know what, I want to run with this. Because what you hear determines what you do. What you hear determines what you do. Information is very pertinent for progress. People act based on information. People act based on what they know. That's why the Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall send you free. Please bring that scripture back on again. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. He said that he may establish his covenant which he swore unto your fathers. As it is, what is the promise that he swore unto our fathers? Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Let's read together. He said, and God blessed them. Somebody say, and God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Every human being is empowered by God to be fruitful, to multiply. Not only to stop at that, to what? To subdue the earth. In other words, God expects something from me to the world. And no matter what I give to the world, God expects it to multiply. In other words, you have a business. God is saying to you that not only could you start business or do what you do can multiply. You were doing it only in Milton Keynes. And all of a sudden you have a branch in Luton. And all of a sudden you have another branch in Dunstable. You are investing in property, and you bought one in Milton Keynes, and you bought another one in London, and you bought another one in Sheffield. You're selling something on the internet, and people are buying it from Milton Keynes, and they're buying it from New York, and they're buying it from Malawi, and they're buying it from everywhere. Replenish the way, and until a point, would you say of Coca-Cola that it has subdued the world or not? Would you say of Coca-Cola that it has replenished the world or not? Would you say of Apple that it has replenished the earth or not? In other words, it's not enough to be fruitful. We have to move and then to multiply the fruit. But we don't stop at multiplication. We go to subdue, becoming a market captain. Somebody with me? And beyond that, we begin to replicate. That's where the prosperity is. That's where the blessing is. That is where the blessedness that God is talking about is. That's the blessing to our fathers. What is economic empowerment? Economic empowerment is the capacity of a person, a woman or man, or women or men, to participate in, contribute to, and to benefit from growth process in ways that recognize the values of their contribution. I repeat that. I've not finished this statement. I want you to write it. It's, economic empowerment is the capacity of women and men to participate in, to contribute to, and benefit from the growth process in ways that recognize the value of their contribution, comma, respect their dignity, and make it possible to negotiate a fairer distribution of the benefit of growth. It's becoming an economic class for you now. Should I repeat that again? Economic empowerment is the capacity of a woman or of women and men to participate in, contribute to, and benefit from growth process in ways that recognize the value of their contribution, respect their dignity, and make it possible to negotiate a fairer distribution of benefit of growth. How do I mean by this expression? Economic empowerment is the ability for you to be participant or a contributor to the benefit of growth in the country, in the society where you are. So, for example, I've used this as an example before. How many of us drive here? You drive. Now, or you take the bus often. How many of us have seen on bridges in Milton Keynes, they write there, is it 25 or 50 million naira, 50 million pounds generation for Milton Keynes development? How many of us have read it? Now, they're saying to you that every month or every now and then, there is $50 million, £50 million, I don't know why I'm all about many countries today. £50 million available for regeneration or for growth of businesses in Milton Keynes. Many of us just read that. Or you hear things like the GDP of the country is so viable. UK economy is one of the best in Europe. And I said the inflation of the country has gone below 1 point something. Now, you are hearing the figures, but if you are not empowered economically, you do not understand how to participate and to benefit from the growth. Is somebody with me? If you are hearing also that there is recession, people are selling their houses, businesses are closing down, and things are happening, you might just be a statistician, or you might just be hearing what they are saying, and it makes no clue. You don't understand it, because you just go to work, you collect your salary, you come back home, you sleep. And many of us, financial figures or financial statements don't make sense to us. Do we understand what I'm talking about? When they are speaking Financial Times, when they are speaking in terms of economy, many of us, it passes over us, we change the channel, we watch football, or you watch, you know, old movies. Something to sensitize you, because you believe it's for certain people. How many of us understand what I'm talking about? Empowerment is for all. We are all contributors, either you understand it or not. The job you are doing, the money you are spending, I don't know how much is in your pocket right now or that is in your account today. Every money that is in circulation is part of the economy. Is somebody with me? Every amount of money, whatever it is, if it is 50 pounds that is in your hand today, you are part of the economy. If you're part of a system and you don't understand it, you will be disadvantage in that economy. It's called marginalization. Many people feel marginalized in a country. Many of us, especially those of us that are of African descent, when we come to nations like this, we feel marginalized. We feel that we are being segregated. We feel as though they are using us. We feel as though we are not empowered. It seems as though some people are better than you. Empowerment is the process of obtaining basic opportunity for marginalized people. I want you to write that down. Empowerment is the process of obtaining basic opportunities for marginalized people. Either directly to those people or through the help of non-profit or non-marginalized others who share their own access to the opportunities. Okay, now let me explain this to you. I'll give you a few examples to break this down to you. Somebody comes here and he starts a company. And he sends out, and in getting his company, he gets a loan, or he even gets the government grant. There is a government grant that is available I believe it's maybe 2,000 pounds or 500, maybe before we finish this series, if I have some of those available, I'll make it available to us. Where the government gives you a certain amount of money. It might not be a lot. It might just be 1.5 for the fact that you want to try out a business. You want to start a business. How many of us have had something like that before? Now, there are those who make money or get rebates because it's their first year in business, and when they ask them, what do you want to do? He said, I want to employ people. In other words, somebody is saying to me, bank, give me money. They say, why should we give you money? I'm going to provide jobs. I'm going to get people empowered. So the person is getting the loan on the basis of a promise of helping the marginalized. Are you with me? He said, how many people are you going to? He said, I'm going to be able to employ 14 unemployed people. I'm going to be able to give jobs to people that don't have a job. And by the time they're speaking like that to banks, by the time they're speaking like that to government parastatals, they believe that, oh, this person is to help the masses. Who are the people in the masses that this person is helping? The marginalized. Are you with me? Now, people do it in profit or they do it in non-profit way. A lot of the time, it's the people that are satisfied that acclaim or supposedly are helping the marginalized, but in every sense, it's actually not help. I'll give you an example. There are so many people, how many of us have watched, you see on TV, and you see adverts. They said to you, donate £2 a month and you'll be helping cats. You'll be saving some wild animal in some part of the world. Now, I'm not saying this to bring down any company or what have you. Now, it is part of economic empowerment for whoever is behind the directors of those companies. The directors of those companies, although it's charity, they will be riding Range Rover. They will have yachts. All expenses can be taken out of the company, what have you. They are taking the money to some cat, really. But really, it is for empowerment and enrichment of themselves. Is somebody getting what I'm saying? But because it looks like, oh, it's a non-profit. A few years ago, I went to do some job at World Mission. The headquarters is here. It's one of the biggest charities in the world. So later on, we're going to start our charity. I researched them. And when I saw how much they are making a year, and I realized that a lot of people go to work there on voluntary basis even, or on a reduced salary. I mean, hundreds of people are working there without salary to just gain work experience. But when I saw it, I see that their turnover a year is over 60 million. They're a charity organization. Are you getting what I'm saying? Now, it's not that they're not going to do their charitable act. They will do their charitable act, but in the process of it, they are also enriched. Are you with me? It's meant for the marginalized, but I'm saying this for us to see that there are both non-profit and profit way of keying into the economy and being part of what is going on in the economy. Is somebody with me? So it's not only an idea of starting a company for profit or what have you, but here's the mistake. Here are some of the errors that many people make, especially for some of us that might be listening to this at some point, or you're listening to me in the third world nation. Many people from the third world nation, especially very passionate young men, they are not empowered themselves economically, and when they are thinking of starting something, they are thinking of starting a non-profit organization. They are thinking of starting an NGO. Now, you can't start an NGO if you are not empowered yourself. And many of them have seen that, oh, if I start an NGO, I can write letter to this company, I can write letter to those company, I can begin to seek for fund. Why are they doing that? Why are they thinking of that? Because they know that if they are at the receiving hand of receiving those money, even if they will help people, at least if water is passing through your hand, at least you won't be wet. At least you'll be wet. You'll be thirsty. Somebody getting this? I want you to take even further note. Empowerment is also includes encouraging and developing the skill for self-sufficiency. I don't know if that my English structure is okay there. Empowerment also includes encouraging and developing the skills for self-sufficiency. with focus on eliminating the future need for charity or welfare in the individual or group. In other words, instead of taking a Do you want me to repeat that? Empowerment is also include encouraging and developing the skills for self-sufficiency with the focus on eliminating the future need for charity or welfare in the individual or group of the group. What do I mean this way? Instead of bringing Oxfam or World Mission or bringing help and coming to build well for a people of a village, instead of coming here and I'm saying, come and be receiving job seekers allowance, come and be receiving housing benefit, I can actually come here and empower people like we are doing right now and teach people how to be productive, how to be skillful, what they can do so that they can earn their own money. My prayer is that everybody in this church or anyone in this church that is at the receiving end in this country, by this time December, we are completely out of that in the name of Jesus. There are two hands to be. You can be at the receiving end where everything is done for you, where the government is the one feeding you, is the lowest level we can be. But there is another hand where you are at the other end of the spectrum. You are the one, actually, it's because of you that other people that are receiving what they are receiving. When you get to that level, you begin to be charged 40% tax in this country. You begin to be charged more taxes. And many people think, I don't want to hand more money, or I don't want to need more money because they are going to tax me. Now, if you earn $15,000 a year, you pay less tax. That's correct, right? You pay 20% tax and earn it. Minimum is 15. So, minimum income is not 15. Minimum income is about 8,000. It's less than 9,000. Will be the minimum income. 11,000. Thank you. That's the minimum income. Now, but the minimum income in terms of taxation is 11. I think it's under 9,000 thereabout before you start hitting tax. Or what have you. So, for example, let's use 9,000. Somebody said, because I don't want to pay tax, I'm going to be earning 9,000, and then the government will subsidize everything else for me. Now, that person is not empowered, because the person is still the marginalized. The lowest people in the community. So the person received 9,000 in salary, but the government subsidized it. All together, all the person could ever come up to earn in throughout that year, through government support or whatever, is about 26,000. Is that how much? 26,000. But when you earn 40,000, for example, you pay tax, but if you earn 40,000, for example, you pay tax and your take home might be about 28,000. So, in other words, you have paid about 12,000 or how much tax. It looks painful that you have paid so much tax. Are you getting me? But in the long run, you have helped those who are on housing benefit. You come to church, you say, I want to be a blessing. But in effect, you have been part of contributing to the economy. You have moved from being the marginalized to being the one that are helping other people to have what to eat on a daily basis. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. But look at it that way, that you are no longer are the one they are feeding, the one they are giving to, but you are now the one that is helping those who are being fed to be fed. Does this make sense to you? That you have to think differently. You have to. Now, here's the goodness that is there. I'm talking about earning now. I've not even gone to starting your own businesses and running your own business. Imagine that you push yourself and you earn 40,000. And then you push yourself more and you start earning 50 something thousand. And again, you started earning 50,000 and your take home is only about 30,000. But here is the good thing about it. By the time you move to that threshold, you begin to move into a threshold that you can personally manage yourself. In other words, it's not just the government that controls your salary, your tax, and NI. By that means, you have a personal accountant. An accountant probably will charges you £100, £150 a month, but balances your account. So certain expenses, like the rich live, certain expenses will come out of the money you are earning. So it's not even the whole amount that you are going to be taxed on, because there are certain deductibles from what you are making. Does this make sense to you? At the end of the day, you live a better life. But you are contributing to the economy. You are contributing that way. You are empowered. But this empowerment is both informative and it's also in terms of skill. What I'm going to be making available to us throughout this week is to give us information. To give us what? And then we're going to be ending it with impartation. Impartation of grace. I, the Lord thy God, giveth thee power to get wealth. I, the Lord thy God, giveth thee power to get wealth. If you don't learn to sow seed, you will never know how to harvest. If you don't learn to sow seeds, you will never be able to harvest. The past 4 years, the past 5 years of my life has been sowing seeds, starting this company, you know, trying to get this one to work, trying to make that one to work. And it takes time sometimes, because many of us, the main reason why many people never start a business or do something is that you start a business, you are expecting, I started a business, pastor, I've been at it now 6 months, I've not made any profit. I always joke about one of my first businesses in this country. I started a business, I paid a lot of money to go for training, for licensing on the company, to get license, I start for exams, I think the registration alone in a year, 1 year registration as at that time, was about £1,400 to register just to be a member of the professional body. And ask me how much was my profit. Both income and profit in a year was how much? £100. Imagine my yearly fee for being a professional member alone is 1,000. My training is over 2,000. But imagine your income and profit, or everything, that the whole amount that enters through the account was £100. Will you back up that business or not? Will you pack it up or not? But then the second year, I believe it was over 18,000. The third year, it was over 50,000. The fourth year, I believe it will be close to over 150,000. Is somebody getting what I'm saying? Now, if you gave it up, the business will probably not be able to do anything at all. One day, the same business will be millions. The same business that I'm talking about now, I might not be able to even say, I have £1,000 salary from it. No. But there are different stages of things. There are some things you start today. Immediately you start it, you are seeing your toro kobo. You are seeing your shillings, your pounds, your dollar, a little bit here, a little bit there. Every business produces something. Every business does what? Produce something. But you must think in terms of being a contributor, not a collector. A what? Let me explain some of the strategy. Strategy one, in which people become economically empowered, is one empowerment strategy is to assist marginalized people to create their own non-profit environment or organization, using the rationale that only the marginalized people themselves can know what their own people need most. So one of the ways in which the world or strong economic country is trying to help people is to help them marginalize themselves to create their own non-profit organizations. So they assist them, they make it easy for them to be able to start a non-profit organization. So let me read from my notes more. Can know what their own people need most and control the organization by outsiders can actually help them to further and enrich the marginalized. In other words, They can come here and say, we are going to empower those who don't have a job to start a women forum for people. So they said to you, I'm going to bring you out, I will train you, I'll give you a training, but you're going to be helping mothers to know how to weave hair. You understand? But you're going to be teaching them, they're not going to be collecting any money. So teach as many women to do what you are doing. But here's what we are going to do. We are going to fund you your basic need in order for you to be able to be taking care of other people or be giving that the skill that we have passed on to you. So here you have things like when NVQ programs, for example, there are organizations that you can join. You can research on your own. There are things you can go to the council and seek for counseling. What can I provide to the community for free? What skill can you teach me that even if it's for me to use it for free? So, for example, they said, look, we'll continue paying you housing benefits, or we'll continue giving you a particular amount of money, but you are working for yourself. You are running an organization, but you are going to be helping people that are pregnant. You're going to be, I don't know if this is making sense to you. And it becomes an organization, or you are helping people whose houses are falling apart. You're just going to knock on doors and find old people that their houses are falling. Now, you are doing something that is non-charitable, or charitable rather, but in the end of it, you are just empowered to do that thing in order for you to be empowered to be part of the economy. So in return, when you are being paid for what you are doing, the government is looking at is that what probably would have been costing them more would be for those people to be calling direct, for those people to be many other, it might cost them a lot more to be able to take care of those who you are reaching. Are you getting what I'm saying? So they look at you as the empowered one, although you are running it on a charity, but you are saving a lot more lives. The government can give me grant and say, take this grant. We did a grant, we got £10,000 to speak to youth and children. So we gathered some youth, we spoke to them about against violence, that don't fight, that when there is fight, this is what you do. Now, we are running a non-charitable program. We are empowering the youth in the community, but we've been paid for it. The payment is for what? For to educate them, for bringing the lecturers to educate them. So there are more things you can do in the community like that, and there are funders who can fund you that, oh, this is my idea. And then you have people like Big Lottery, you have whatever that can say, oh, you have a fantastic idea. We're going to give you some money to go and help those people. And there are people that are ready to fund you for 3 years. There are some organizations that are ready to fund you for 5 years. But that is just one way of being empowered in the community. That's one way of being empowered in the community. Strategy two. This is the strategy to make it easy for the marginalized to get engaged in the economic system of the country by starting their own business. This strategy is one of the advantages of living in the Western country. In Western countries such like this one, it is so simple for you to create a company. They make it so easy. In the country where I was born, in Nigeria, you need to go through about 13 different processes in order for you to register a business. It has to go from one business, from one office to another. It probably takes an average of about 3 weeks to 3 months. You'll be carrying file from places to places just that you want to register a business. But right here, you go right there on the internet. Within 3 hours, I mean, within 20 minutes, you have incorporated your business. Within 3 hours, they have given you a company number. That same hour, you have the certificate of incorporation. The next minute, you can jump in a bank across the road. That very day, you can have an account open for your business. And you're already in business. I want you to know that there are opportunities out there for you to start your own business. And starting a business does not stop you from your current job or employment. Are you with me? I spoke in this church last year, I believe, or 2 years ago, on two types of prosperity. I taught on the hunter and the cultivator. And I said, the hunter is the one who goes for the job 9 to 5 or 5 to 7, whatever time that you're working. That is your normal job or your day-to-day job or your salary job makes you a hunter. And one of the things that I said in that teaching is the fact that the prosperity of the hunter is dependent on the forest. The prosperity of the hunter. In other words, if the hunter goes into the field and there is no animal, if a hunter goes there and says, oh, here is my catapult, I want antelope today, or I want a big rat, and he gets there and all the animals don't show up, the hunter does not get job. So as a hunter, one day you can get to employment and they say to you, there's no more job. There's nothing the hunter can do. One day the hunter can get there and they say, we don't like your face. There's nothing the hunter can do. And as a hunter, what do hunter do? Once this bush is not working, they start looking for the next place to hunt. Will you hunt for the rest of your life? That's the question. Would you like to live a kind of a life where all through your life, all that you're going to do is to be a hunter? And then I spoke about the cultivator. That the cultivator does not even need to live where he is or where she is. From the comfort of his or her own home, she can run and she can cultivate. So that when he or she is hungry, she opens the backyard, she kills or he kills a lamb. He kills something that is already been cultivated. The advantages of being a cultivator is the fact that you control your own life. You control your own time. You are the boss. You are the one in charge of your life. Now, one of the downsides of being a cultivator is that it also gives you opportunity to be lazy. If you ain't going to work, if you're not going to be effective, you will still be a cultivator, but you're not going to put in your best. If you put in a little, you think you're already doing enough. Whereas, the seeds that you carry in your hand, or the business that you're running, has the power, has the proclivity to produce more, only if you can put in more effort. Is somebody getting this? So what are the types of companies that are possible out there? I'll be sharing that with us in the course of the following weeks. The third strategy that I'd like to focus on, or the direction to which I would like this to be, is the combination of all the strategies, of the two above strategies, available but empowered by God or by God's inspiration for the enrichment of the life of the marginalized. That means you decide that every strategy out there, both in being useful to humanity and both in making money, I want to combine everything together. How do you do this? He said, I, the Lord thy God, I give thee power. You ask God question, and you ask the world question. You do a research. You ask question. What are people lacking where I am? What do people lack where I am? So, for example, yesterday I asked for bitter cola. And I couldn't find bitter cola. So I asked Pastor Bola, where can we find bitter cola? And Pastor Bola said to me, he will call somebody in Manchester and they will go and find, have they ordered my burger? Is he on the way, sir? Fantastic. Now, I can decide if I'm looking for bitter cola and I can't find bitter cola in Milton Keynes. I can decide, okay, how can I import a bitter cola? From where can I bring it into? But here are the destiny. How many people in Milton Keynes need bitter cola? So, because I identify a problem does not mean that problem becomes a business immediately. But because I'm looking for it, here is how many people do business. The fact that they just think of the business, they start investing money. And when it doesn't work, they begin to blame God. In fact, they will come to Pastor, pray for these goods. I've had them since, I've not been able to sell them. The devil has been, it's not the devil sitting on it. There's nobody that needs the service. There's nobody that needs the product. The fact that you are passionate about it does not mean that it's required. You just sit down with it and be the one eating it yourself. How many people want bitter cola now? Should I see if I can start a company selling one? Yes, Orogo. 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 I like that. Orogo. Praise God. It is I don't know how to call it. It's like a herb. It's a fruit. Is it fruit? It's like a nut. But it's a very, that's why they call it nut. Cola nut. It's a bitter cola. It's a nut, but it's very bitter, but it's like antibiotic. It's not like, it's more powerful than any antibiotic out there. It cleanses the system. Also, when you lose your voice, if you can't finish half of it before your voice will clear up. So it's but it's extremely bitter. That's why they call it bitter. Sirs, I don't know what that is. Something like that. But I'm just saying. I'm just using that as an example. Identify if you must run a company or if you must be empowered. I want you to go back to list what I said you might be needing. Number one, you need information. You need what? Information. Number two, you need skills. You need what? Skills. Number three, you need resources. You need what? Resources. Now, when we talk about resources, many people only attribute resources to money. Money is not the only resources that is required. As a matter of fact, many people don't start a business because they say they don't have money. Habakkuk chapter 2, what does he say to us? He said, I will stand upon my watch and I will wait to hear what he will say unto me. He said, when he said unto me, what did he say? The first thing you must do if you want to start a business or to be empowered is to write. He said unto me, write the vision down. If you don't write it, you can't do it. The major reason for failure in business. The major reason for failure in business. I repeat. The major reason for failure in business is because there's no written plan. Sir? Exactly. Now, the thing is that many good people have many good plans. Many good people also have hands-on with what they want to do. But you know what? If the business cannot be written down, and no matter how short, there are 70 pages business plan, there are 2 pages business plan. The business that I said to you that I want to, I first of all wrote a vision. When I decided this is the direction, I wrote a whole vision of everything I want to do. And in that thing, I have at least a page each of the companies that I want to form. What that is called synopsis. What this company will do, the kind of services it's going to provide, the regulations bodies that I need to confront to get licenses, when it might be, the cost of it, and you list what it is down. You need to be able to say, write it down and we'll do what? Make it plain. Make it plain. Do you want to sell soup? Write it down. Give it a name. Black woman selling soup. Company incorporated. Write it down. Selling soup to people. You decide what kind of soup do you want to sell? How many type of soup would you want to sell? What country species are you going to have? Is it only Nigerian soup? Is it Zimbabwean soup? Is it Ghanaian soup? Is it a combination of them all? Where are you going to get the recipes from? How long does it? And before you realize that you don't even need a professional to write a plan. You already, there are information that you know. You can already sit down and begin to jot down what you need. If you can think, you will do it. If it comes from you, you will do it. The reason many people don't also succeed is that they want other people to do all the work for them, but they want to make all the money. When I mean all the work for them, I mean they want somebody else to do all the thinking for them. It's okay for you to employ people to manage your businesses, but the thought, the thinking of giving birth, no matter how powerful it is, somebody cannot carry pregnancy for you. You must be the one to be pregnant with your business. You must be the one to be pregnant with your business. No matter who is helping you out, follow them up. Call them. Write your plan. Don't let anybody be on the driving seat of starting your business. I repeat that. Never let somebody else be at the driving seat of driving your business. If not, they drive your business to their own house. They drive their business to their own house. So please, learn that about the business. Let me quickly say to us here, I'll still break all of this down for us next week and the week after. I pray that 3 weeks will be sufficient for us. To be marginalized is to be relegated, and you don't want to be there. To be marginalized is what? To be relegated. There are different class of people that live in every city, in any environment. They class them from A to E. You have the A1, you have the A2, you have the B class, you have the C class, you have the D class. Do you know that people that come from immigrants are usually starting their life from the E? They are the lowest. They are the marginalized. They will live at the cheapest part of the city. They will live at the lowest part of the city. But you know one thing, there is a tribe. They are the best form of immigrants anywhere in the world. They are called the Israelis. When the Israelis enter into any country, they might enter with 2 weeks visa. But they are coming with a mindset that I am the best. I'm entering into this city and I'm going to prosper. So they start the city, they look, what is the information that I need? What is the skill that I need? What is the skill that I require? What are the resources that is required for me to be able to do what I have come here to do? So when they realize that, they join up with somebody and they might not even be paying them salary. They stay in that company and they are learning that thing. And they are doing, it's called apprenticeship. And they are there. And before you know it, 4 years, 5 years, or whatever, they've learned all that they need to do. They have all the knowledge, and before they know it, before you realize it, you say, how many years are you in this country? So I'm here 10 years, and you see them, they are millionaires. Because as an Israeli, you don't think of yourself as the lowest in the community. It's an anomaly. It's an anomaly. They don't see themselves as strugglers. Are we together? So please, see yourself, somebody say, I'm not marginalized. To be marginalized also is to treat a person or group or concept as insignificant or peripheral. To treat a person or group or concept as insignificant or peripheral. So you see this set of people being used as the lowest job, factory workers, laborers. Where they work with all their hands and they are laboring and laboring and laboring. And almost all of those companies where you are doing the labor job, you are enriching just 2, 3, or 4 people who own the company. And those people are living in millions. I read today that Apple posted a profit, their best profit since Apple has been founded. Now, you go to China and see the guys that are working in Apple. They are working their hearts 24 hours. And some of those guys are on $150 per month. You go to Apple right here in Milton Keynes. You see all of those little guys, working so hard, rolling up and down the stairs. But at the end of the day, ask them their salary. It might not just be up to £1,000. Take home, after tax. But you've just heard that the company has, and if a company is telling you that they made $62 billion, I want you to know that in terms of tax, a lot already has been cut out. So distribute $62 billion into, just cut it into half and take 30 billion of it and divide it into the salary of all their workers, all of them. Do you know how much pay rise those people? In other words, don't stay at being treated as insignificant. It is at your peril. Don't stay there. Don't stay at the lowest level. Be discontent with the lowest paying level of jobs. I say this at this time. If you refuse to develop yourself, you remain the enemy. You understand? If you refuse, because some of us are comfortable with the comfort zone. Some of us will count every reason why we are limited and we are okay with our limitations, so we stay there. God is not offended. But for every member of this church this year, we are moving to the next level. We are moving to the next level. We are moving to higher dimension. In the name of Jesus. To be marginalized is to be looked down on or upon. At my last employment, circular employment, doing in a project management role, I was earning some money, which was good at the time, but there was a young lady, 19-year-old, earning £500 a day. £500 a day. It's ridiculous. She was earning almost 3 times what I was earning a day. And the funny thing is that this little girl tell me go and do mind map. And at that time, I don't know mind map at all. And because I don't know mind map, she want me to go home. 19-year-old. And the funny thing is there's nothing we're doing in the job. We drink tea. Somebody else was talking to me yesterday about the job. She said, like this job. The person is getting well paid, maybe 400, 500 pounds. Get to the work. He said, a lot of the time we just do meeting after one meeting and we have another meeting, we drink coffee. He said, that's how the contract has run for 1 year. You understand? Yeah, some of these things. Somebody else just got a job. He started on Wednesday, on Monday. He said, Pastor, I don't know why they are paying me this kind of money. He said, I just get there, I open computer, I put this card in. He said, to be honest, I don't see a big deal in this thing. I don't see a big deal. Now, he decided to empower himself and move to the next level. But after that level, there's still another level. After that level, there's still another level. And there is another level. But if you don't, eventually, somebody's going to look down on you. Somebody's going to talk to you anyhow. Somebody's going to treat you the way you don't want to be treated. Because if you don't raise yourself, other people will still look down on you anyway. I've given us that there are opportunities out there. I'm going to be reading out some again to us. I'm going to be articulating some again to us that there are what is possible. Even whilst you have employment, even whilst you have your current job, there are things you can begin to do on the side as a cultivator. Lastly, to be marginalized, to be regarded as a person or group that are lesser. To be marginalized, they say, I don't want to mention the name of the country, but any time now, when we want to repair something in the house, when we want to clean the house, there's a particular nationality that comes to mind. You want to paint your house? You want to repair something in your house? You just say, let's call this, I have one, you know? Sir? Oh, okay, somebody want me to use it. He said, let me call a Polish person to come and... Because now we've already thought that it's only those people who can. By the way, most of those people have now learned their lesson. They run it as their own business. You might be thinking that they're just painting here. Some of them are making $100,000 a year. Some of them are making serious money because they are running their own business. Is somebody with me? Running your own business does not mean that the business is easy. Running your own business does not mean that you lie down flat in your room and then money is flowing into your account. To be successful, you need to work hard. To be successful, you need to work hard. We're talking about economic empowerment. Let me just give us what the economy means. Because I said for you to be empowered economically, you need information. You also need skills. and resources. You need information, you need skills, and you need resources. Economy. Hallelujah. Please, let's not be distracted. Every distraction is distracting me. Hallelujah. The economy is the state of a country or region in terms of production and consumption of goods and services and supply of money. That's the economy. Do you want me to repeat that? The economy is the state of a country or region in terms of production and consumption of goods and services and the supply of money. I break that down for us. What is the economy? Hallelujah. Are we all together? You have pen to sell. She has water to sell. The government prints paper. To be able, the paper is like a bridge, or the paper becomes like a carrier, or the wheelbarrow, or the car that will drive your pen to our water. Are you with me? Before this time, the world operates what we call trade by barter. Meaning that you have your pen or you have yam. She has potato. Or you have rice. She has gold. You want gold. You bring some yam. So she measures that the gold that I have is 4 carats. You say, I have 16 yam. She said, no. For me to give you 4 carat gold, you will need to pick 98 yam. So you go back and you plant and you cultivate and you irrigate more, because you now know that the value of the gold you want has gone up. So what the economy has become as is now that instead of you exchanging goods between each other, and instead of you rendering just services, so I come to you, I'm owing you. During those days, somebody is owing another person. He said, I can't pay this money. So he said, he gives their 4 or 5 children to render services so that that money will be paid. Are you with me? They're still running the economy. But the money has entered into the economy as a balancer or as transaction. Money. Transaction was already going on, but money became the conveyor of the transaction. Are you with me? Such that what I have, I take my gold, I render it into the bank give me paper, or I put it, I store it in the bank. And the bank said, for what you have stored in here, I give you a card, you have money. So when I'm coming to you, I don't need to bring my product. I just bring my paper. With my paper, you give me what you want. So the economy really is the amount of goods and services plus money that is being circulated in any country. That's the economy. So when you say, oh, the economy of the country is booming, it means that the exchange of goods and services that is being conveyed or carried about with money is getting better or is getting worse. So when they say the economy of a country is not booming, that means people are buying less or selling less. Money is circulating less. Does this make? So in other words, every £1 that is being transacted in the economy or in the country on a daily basis is part of the economy. The £5 or £50 in your pocket right now, once you bring it out and you transact with McDonald's, you are engaging the economy. When you remove £10 from your cash machine right here, you are contributing to the GDP, you are contributing to how much balance that bank has that day, their closing balance. When you make your salary and your salary is paid into a bank, when that bank closed that day, you have contributed to the economy. other words, if your contribution to the economy is £800 a month, you are part of the growth of that economy the day you start putting 80,000 a month. Are you with me? You have become a major key player in that economy. But imagine you are living in a place and you are not putting anything in the economy. You are marginalized. You are the one that they are looking down on. You are part of the lowest standard people. Because you are not rolling. The ball is rolling, but you are not part of rolling it. And if the ball is rolling and you are not part of rolling it, the ball might roll over you. Is this making sense to you? The economy also is the careful management of available resources. The economy also is the careful management of available resources. So the amount of money that is available in the economy, or the resources that are available, the gifts and the talent, I am here contributing to the economy. How? I am managing this people that are here giving you information, and the information that is being passed out to you right now can change the economy, because there are something that are intangible as yet. There are ideas that are just in your mind. There are things that are not yet born, that when you born them right now, it can begin to make the economy to roll. Are you with me? So we're managing the skills. We're pushing something out. We're helping to say, be a contributor to the economy. Let's look at the word empowerment. Empowerment, a management practice of sharing information. Empowerment is management practice of sharing information, reward, and power with people so that they can take initiative and make decisions to solve problems and improve services and performance. Do you want me to repeat that? Empowerment is the management practice of sharing information, reward, and power with people so they can take initiatives and make decisions to solve problems and improve services and performance. So we are sharing the pertinent information. We are giving the reward, or sometimes we are giving reward and power to you so that you can take initiative and make decisions to solve the problems around you. Empowerment is based on the idea that giving people skills, resources, authority, opportunity, motivation, as well as holding them responsible and accountable for the outcome of their action, that will contribute to their competence and satisfaction. That will contribute to what? To their competence and satisfaction. Information can improve your performance. Information can improve your reward. Let me round up with this, and next week we'll go a bit deeper. You have to take opportunities in this country. You have to take advantage of the opportunities around you. If you must be economically empowered, you have to take advantage of the opportunities that are around you. Number two, you have to think differently. You have to start thinking differently. You have to start thinking. Stop thinking about what is limiting you. Stop thinking that I can't do this. Stop thinking that you must be a benefit collector. Stop thinking that you can't do it. Stop thinking that it's only employment that can make you. Nobody can become rich with employment. Stop thinking that other people don't want to do something for you. Start taking responsibility. Instead of expecting from others, start thinking that you are the one to give to more people. Start thinking that you are better. Start thinking that you can. There are skills available for you. Start thinking that you know all the answers. Start thinking. Start thinking differently. Number three, you have to ask. Ask. Whatever you don't know, ask. Asking is like digging. Keep digging until you find water. Keep asking until you find answer. Keep asking until you what? Until you find an answer. What can I do? I wrote something in 2008. I said, what will I do with $1 million? With £1 million, what will I do? And I wrote down in a textbook what I would do with £1 million. Of now, I'm thinking, what will I do with £10 million? What I do with £10 million? 10 things that I can do. Start thinking. Start thinking. If you have £1 million today, what would you have been doing? Because if you can think, okay, maybe £1 million is too much for you. Because some of us are thinking, Pastor, £10 million. £1 million. Million. Long. Okay, what will you do with £10,000? What will you do with £50,000? Because many of us say, because there is no money, I can't start the business. It's a big lie. Every business starts with what you have, your brain, your mouth, your hand. How many of us have ever started a business? Ever started a business? Star Jackie, you've never started a business. The one you are doing is your business. You didn't need any money for that. But how, you start asking questions. How can I? There are those who are doing that same business that are making $100,000 a year. How do they do it? Maybe they got a shop. Maybe they dress the shop up. Maybe they have employees. Why is that person not you? How do they get? Where did they get money to? Do you know what? There is a lady that we know. She had that kind of an idea. And she got a free shop and office here in Milton Keynes from the council. Free. With every equipment that she needs inside it. Because until you learn to write what you will do, you will never do anything. You have to first think differently. That the possibility, I can be the chief managing director, the CEO of my own company. I can be a director of a company. My company can be bigger than this. If not, one will just continue Kira, Kita. Number four, you have to work on yourself. As I'm rounding up, you have to what? Work on yourself. You have to what? Work on yourself. Assumption is the lowest level of knowledge. If you think that you are good enough, you just might be shooting yourself in the foot. I need more skills to be the leader that God wants me to be. I need more skills. I need more understanding to be able to do the things that I want to do with my life. You need more information. I was speaking to somebody just this evening, and the person was charging me about £900 for something that I think in the past I would just sit down and do, but I cannot do it. I cannot do it as pedantic as those people would do it. And the person says, you pay us about £900, but we'll do it, we'll give it to you in about 1 week. We'll make it this, it will have this. And in my head, I'm thinking, £900. And something inside of me is saying, and maybe you can find somebody that can do it for £150. Now, the truth is that if you give it to somebody that will do it £150, they will give you £450 brain work. But if you have gone to the best in the country, and they can render that service for you, if you pay for it, maybe you will get the benefit of the best. If somebody gets what I'm saying, think, work on yourself. Do something. Work on yourself. One of the ways to work on yourself is to find information. Is to go for skill. Go and improve your skill. Go and learn. The council have programs for people that want to start their own business. How to manage your own account. Free programs are there with adult education on how to account it, maybe 3 weeks or 4 weeks. If you take, I think, adult education, they usually have a leaflet. Pastor Bola, please, tomorrow, if we can call them or find, they have an office 3 blocks away from here, we can find some of those leaflets. You find that they have hundreds of courses that are available, some of them only £30 for 8 weeks, that you can learn how to build a website, how to take photographs, how to learn to a lot of things that you want to do, that the skills is available. The community is always providing some sort of skills for you in the area that you want to do something. Is somebody getting this? How to make cake. One of my cousins came here a few years ago, and she saw the way my wife makes meat pie. She said, please, sis, teach me this. She taught her how to make meat pie, cake, or what, a few things, a few days. She learned. She went to London, developed the passion, went to school more and learned more with catering. Today she, I saw a cake she made. She makes a cake of a whole human being, the picture of the human being. I said, really? Today she's a hot. I was speaking to her. She said, no, the reason why I can afford to travel right now is that I don't need any job. I work for myself. I said, people now call me everywhere to make a cake for them. She makes cake and hence thousands. Now, she has the personality to drive it. She can talk to you, you know, and she likes party. So, as she's doing one, she's collecting more. You won't do cake, me. Are you not going to be 30 years old? I will do you cake. He said, who see, it's too expensive. He said, how much do you have? Just bring 200. He said, 200. Okay, I'll do it at 120. She has collected the money right then and there. He said, so call me. Show me your color. And tell me what you want it to be. She made a cake for us during the anniversary or what have you. But you can do something. You can sell something. Even if it's water. You can offer a service even if it's not a product. Lastly, you don't need money first. You don't always need money first. Luke chapter 14 verse 28 says, he said, who is the man that wants to start, build a house that will not first of all, some of us don't say I need money, but you don't even know how much. You see, if I get anything like, even if it's just 5,000 pounds, if I have just 5,000 pounds, I will start. No. The starting point of any business is not even money. It's planning. It's planning. It's writing it down. It's projecting it. A lady was speaking with us, with my wife and I, I was with my wife yesterday. I rang the lady. The lady was there when we were opening the first account of this church. When we were registering, the lady used to be part of the meeting before this church started. When I would just gather a few people and we'll be doing meeting. This is what God is telling me. This is what we will gather like this in a room, and we'll be talking to you. He said, you know what? She walks just down here in a bank. He said, each time I pass and I'm seeing, he said, I'm just looking, see, to pass on this thing from just a few of us as a meeting. At that point, to get registered with the charity commission, they asked us for 5,000 pounds. There was no 5,000 pounds. All I got is, I thought outside of the box, my wife and I put what we have down, and we got the remaining as a promised note of letter from a few individuals that if we don't raise this money in 1 year, don't worry. And to the glory of God, the church by itself has enough in the first year. They didn't say they want the money, just say to have passed through our account. But to the glory of God. But I now know somebody else who wants to register a church, and they are telling the person that you need 5,000 pounds to register. I say, you don't need. He said, you are hanging with me. And they said that. I said, sir, is it not something that I have done? I've been there. We didn't even have 500 pounds. We started and he said, if you don't have the 5,000 pounds, you can. There is a way around it. It's not, money is a barrier, but you can always surmount it. You can always surmount it. Praise Jesus. Oh, did I say last? Not last year. Seek advice. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22. In the multitude of counsel, there is safety. And lastly, let me end with this. Starting from where you are, another subtitle. I'll run through this in 5 minutes and then we'll close. We'll take the communion and we'll be on our way home. Starting from where you are. Starting from where you are, to be economically empowerment, you first of all want to know where you are. So I'm assuming that where you are is that you have a job at hand. Or you have an employment. Or you have a source from which money is coming from you. So change, number one thing you want to do from where you are is to change the kind of problem that you are solving at your company that you are now. Daniel 1, verse 17 to 20. Daniel 1, 17 to 20. Change the kind of problem. Because you are only being paid for the problems that you are solving. So if you are not getting paid, or if you are getting paid without solving a problem, you are a marginalized person. That means the state or group or charity is helping you just basic level of survival. Does that make sense to us? Change your role. That's one way you can improve where you are. So you can probably sometimes renegotiate your stance. But first of all, change the problem. Because if you want more money, you have to solve bigger problems. Let me say something to you. There is nobody who does their job correctly who their boss will not want to give a raise. There's none. If you are very good to that company, the company will do everything possible to keep you. Does this make sense to you? Are we there? Daniel chapter 1, verse 17 to 20. Daniel 1, 17 to 20. Media team, we need to rehearse how to be faster. As for these four children, God gave them what? Knowledge and skills in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Verse 18. Now at the end of the day that the king, he should bring them into the province of the, brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. Yes? And the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel. When you get to a point when none is like you in your company, I'm telling you, one thing about being good is that, like I said, every good and services, you might not be bringing good to your company, but you are rendering a soft service that is increasing the bottom line of that company. Let me also say this. If you are not increasing the profit margin of your company, you are costing your company. Invariably, every dead weight, that's why when they want to sack people, they sack people. They don't need to mention your name. It's not your individual. They serve the lower performing, those who are coming late, those who are non-performing, those who are not following the rules. They get rid of them because every non-performer is contributing to the negativity. Every company in red, there are people in that organization that are responsible for it. The light bill is going. There are those who don't think that way. They just don't think that because we work in Tesco, it's so big. It's so big that you don't even think that Tesco pay light bill. You don't even think that the till or wherever you are working, you don't even think they repair it or they paid for it. Some of us just think what we will get at the end of the month. So because of that, we don't put in what will help the company. We don't think we go because we see ourselves, I just got my own hours and I'm going home. But you see some people, the way they do the job, the way they smile at people, that means there is a problem in the organization. They are the one everybody wants to see. They are the go-getter. And that person is coming to the manager that, please, I'm leaving this organization. The manager said, no, you can't leave. You can't leave. He said, but why can't I leave? We have 50 people doing my job. He said, you don't understand. You can't leave. You have become the face of Tesco. You are the reason why everybody comes here. Every time people are fighting, you are the moderator. You are the one that gets in here. This place would have not been open at this time if not for you. Until you get to that point, he said, like Daniel, Ananias, Mishael, and Azariah, therefore stood before the king. Verse 20, everybody together. From where you are, that's what you want to do. You have to be somebody that motivates your boss. You have to be somebody that is 10 times better. That's why I spoke earlier. That you have to improve yourself. You have to increase yourself. You have to better yourself. You have to be somebody that when your boss is going home, or the company or your supervisor is going home, they just think, can I do without this lady? Can I do without this person? Is it really possible? Well, it's not only in your skills, in your manner of wisdom, in your knowledge, in your understanding. An excellent spirit is just sitting around you. When somebody gets to that point whereby they can see, I mean, that's what happened to Daniel, that he was able, they didn't even record it of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Kings were passing him from kings to king, from king to king. He was the prime minister because the guy was just so good. Number two, change your attitude and accuracy with which you solve the problem. Change your attitude and the accuracy with which you solve the current problem that you are solving. Colossians chapter 2, verse 22 to 25. change the attitude and the accuracy with which you solve the current problem. What do I mean by that? Let's read Colossians chapter 2, verse 22 to 25 very quickly. Which are all to perish with the using. Let's all read it together, everybody. Sorry, Colossians 3, 22 to 25. Servant, obey in all your masters, according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but singleness of heart, fearing God. Listen there. Your attitude affects the performance of the company. He says, servant, obey your masters. Many of us, we are working in people in places, but you don't like who you are working to. Resign there and go and work somewhere else. Connect your heart. Obey people. Your boss can't want one thing and you want another thing. You are taking the company on a different trajectory. Are you with me? You can never contribute to profit when you are not in alignment. He said, not with eye service. There are some people, it's when the boss comes, they started, but before the boss comes, all they are doing is their own job. It's their own work. They're sending their own emails. They're on Facebook. They are on one, but once the boss comes in, hey, they start papa. Oh, so when are you delivering that? Once the boss leaves, it's eye service. If you cannot do behind me what you are doing in front of me, you are not contributing to the progress of the company. You are just there to earn your living. You are there as a user. You are there to use me. You are there to use the company. You're there to take out or to drain the resources of the company. You do not know when that boss goes home and is thinking, oh, we have 600,000 to pay in salary. And some of them might not even be able to think. But you are just laughing behind computer. You are just playing. You are just using the resources. Some people even go to the extent of using the company machine. Using the company, whatever, they make their own product and they are selling. There are some people, they make their own clothes, make every other thing. And they say, Ogata. Ogauta. The money of the allowance will pay. That means that the boss sells, the boss doesn't sell. That means Oga is the boss. Either the boss make profit or the boss doesn't make profit. Somebody just said, what do I care? My own is that my salary should be paid. And you see some of these people, they are the worst attitude. When their salary is not paid, you see them, they will go to court. They say, I know two-piece law of employment in the UK, the two-piece law. I know the two-piece law very well. My salary has been delayed. But ask them, have they been a contributor to that salary coming? The money is not there to pay. We bought the company, and the first month, there were about 22 staffs to pay. How many staffs? 22. And when they gave us the wage bill, myself and the partner, before the end of the month, we were running here, running there, looking which student to pay. And all of a sudden, I buy 22 staff. And when you see your wage bill is over 100,000, I say, I don't buy my KT. But all people hear is that, you see, he has a big company, he has 22 staffs. You see, he's a very big man, but they don't know the sweat that he's sweating. They think that he has eaten hot food, that's why he's sweating. But the truth is that he's looking for salary to pay. Verse 23. I have to close. And whatever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. If no matter the company you are working with, no matter who you are working with, do it heartily. Let your heart be sold out, because the Lord will reward in secret. He rewards in the open. He takes your heart. You can never be blessed beyond your heart. I'm telling you the truth. That's why the Bible says, he that is not faithful with that which is another man's. He said, who will give him his own? You will always see the clue for prosperity by how you treat what is somebody else's. Stop thinking that thing belongs to the government. Treat it as though it's yours. Treat that company as though it's yours. Then you will see the way God will bless you. Look at your environment as though it's yours. Let people be able to thank you, to be able to appreciate you. One of my previous boss in terms of church came here. I think when we just came in here, and was saying to myself, Pastor, what are you? He said, I'm not surprised. Because he could travel, he could do anything. The way I will run his church office or what have you, it's as though it's me. I will fight anybody that is going reluctant. I'm there on a daily basis. My head is thinking the work. So he said, I'm not surprised. I won't be surprised. I'm confident that this guy, he can. Your heart must be connected. Verse 24. Knowing that the Lord shall receive the reward of the inheritance for ye serve the Lord Christ. If you are working for Tesco, you are working for Milton Keynes Council, or you are working for anybody, you are actually, everybody was created by God. You are actually working for the Lord. I'm telling you, you are actually working for who? For the Lord. Praise Jesus. If what I think happened is what happened, it's not going to be funny. I've just closed my notes without saving. I think I did. We'll need Brother Maxwell to help me here. But not now. Maybe when we finish. Okay. I've spent so much time typing that message. You can't just go like that. I hope I've not saved it. Huh? Okay, we can recover it. Thank you. Number three, change the company you are solving the problem for. Ruth chapter 1 to 4. Chapter 1, chapter 2. You know the story of Ruth? Change the company. If you are not getting well paid, or maybe you are working in a place you are not getting paid, but you realize that your skill can earn you money, change the company. Stop thinking, no man created you. You say, oh, if I leave the company, they will feel me, whatever. Leave first. You might not just leave abruptly. Arrange what you want to do with them. Make plans that, I want to go and earn money here. But you are the chief in command of your own life. Are you with me? So renegotiate your terms. Or find somewhere, find another company that you can solve that problem for. Does this make sense to anybody? Number four, ask your boss to correct you of any behavior in you. Or any behavior, ask your boss to correct you of any behavior in you that agitates him. Psalm 119, verse 122 to Psalm 119, verse 124 to 125. Let's read that. One thing about David is this. One of the ways David became a friend of God is, as I was preparing this, the Holy Spirit was showing me David. You see, David is one of the only few people in the Bible, just a few people in the Bible that always engage God in conversation. He's messed up. He said, God, try me and check my heart. When he knows there is something, he said, God, create in me a new heart. God, search me. God, make me. Deal with me, your servant, according unto thy mercy. He realized that he has fumbled. He said, and teach me thy status. Verse 25. He's saying that I am correctable. Correct me. Let me know if I didn't do it well. If you don't like it, just let me know. I will change it. I will redo it. That's what he's saying. If the time I came did not please you, can you just tell me? Let me know. Let your boss know that you are corrigible. That you would like him to let him know to correct you of anything you are doing that agitates him. So from tomorrow, go to your boss or your supervisor and just tell anything that you don't like that I do, please let me know. Because I just love this job. I love your relationship. I like the way you treat me. In case I agitate you, don't know. That person will all of a sudden start trusting you in a higher dimension. Are you getting what I'm saying? If you're ever thinking of a pay raise or what have you, he'll start recommending you. Verse 25, he said, I am thy servant. Give me understanding that I may know that. He said, let me know what kind of tea you like. Because I realize that you spend so much time on. He said, really, but you are busy too. He said, just let me know. Give me understanding of how you want me to work with you. Give me understanding of what you would like me to do at this time or at that time. And you regularly do those things, you find out that the person makes you a pal. There's nothing you are asking for that the person is not going to do. That's what we're talking about. From where you are right now. Number five, become a true protege of your superiors, your supervisors. Become a true protege of your supervisors. of your superiors, pursuing his or her standard counsel of excellence, or counsel and standard of excellence. Become a true protege of your superior, pursuing his or her counsel and standard of excellence. Don't do things just the way you want. Wait until you are a boss of your own before you start doing things the way you want. Let your protege, let your superior, let them know that they are training you, they are teaching you. Don't become proud. When you begin to work with somebody and you are feeling prouder than them, actually the real thing you need is the door. They need to show you the door. Some of us, our attitude, we are bigger than our boss in our mind. And some of us, in our mind, we always feel that we are better than our boss. You can do the job better than them. They said, on his lies the head. Until you start wearing that crown, you really don't know what those were there. Let's read as we close. Matthew chapter 14, verse 18 to 20. Matthew 4, 18 to 20. Okay, now I see what happened. I found my note. Praise God. Ooh. Are we there? 18. Chapter 4, verse 18 to 20. Let's go. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw the two brethren, Simon called Peter. Follow me. They became protege immediately. These guys were expert fishermen. But someone said, you know what, I want to train you. I want to lead. Immediately they became subordinates to him. Eventually when he left, they became the boss. Each of them had their own parish or their own what have you. But you must learn to learn from the superior. And let them feel that you are following. Know that you want to overtake them. In your place of work, stop proving as though you are in university. Stop talking to them about your plan to start a business. Spend your own extra time to promote your own business. Stop using their hours to do your own business. Stop using their hours, and in front of them, you are selling your own market to their people. Finish their work first. Do all that you have to do first. Let them be pleased with you. Let them know that you are a true staff, a true protege, and watch it. You just find that out. Because if you can secure where you are, you will jump to where you need to get to. There's a testimony of a young man who went to university, and in university was so productive. I was in Nigeria in September. He was giving testimony. Bishop Oyedepo granted me opportunity to give testimony alongside him and one other person at his 60th birthday. Just the three of us. I think by the grace of God, it goes down in history at least. On that night of the celebration, just the three of us granted testimony. Now, his testimony is so fascinating to me in the fact that this young boy was so productive in his university years that before he left uni, he has employed over 100 people in his phone business. Over how many people? They covered many cities in the country just making calls and providing them with shop and umbrella. He finished university, he went somewhere to serve as a youth corp. And in the youth corp, the company he went to do the youth corp for, they said that the way this guy works, he's a workaholic. He runs the man's business in such a way, the man said, you, I know you're a copper. Everybody else can go, but you have to stay. He stayed for another 4 years or so and ran the man's business to the point that eventually he had to leave. When he was leaving, it was not at his own recommendation. The man said, look, you are becoming too big and you are so old, I can't keep you. I shouldn't keep you. You know what? The man gave him a whole estate with houses and gave him 30 million naira and said, I trust you. I believe in you. Go and start your company. We will deal with you as a consultant. Any area I need your help, He said, but he gave him a whole estate, not a house. He gave him a whole estate. That man must be extremely blessed because of the person I'm talking about. He must have been what? Extremely blessed. I have another friend who today is a PA to one of the biggest pastors in Africa. When he was in uni, this pastor in Africa, who has one of the largest churches in Lagos now, he was just an assistant. This pastor goes to campus to do programs inside campus. This boy voluntarily organizes the pastor's program with no fee. But the excellency with which he did, or he was doing the job, the man saw him. For someone that is not getting paid, and he's doing this job so excellently this way, he's sending in his report at whatever. He's motivated, not 1 year, not 2 years, not 3 years, not 4 years. You know, consistently, you know, doing work with no benefit. So he came here, he studied, he went back home. He was in another church. And this pastor came to that church as a guest minister and saw him. Ah, you are here. You are back from your study. He told the pastor, he said, you know that position that we're advertising in my job? He said, this is the person. Is any other person they are interviewing? He doesn't need interview. Send him to me. Now, the other pastor has him, but he said, look, I'm your father in the Lord. I need this guy. He said, why, sir? He said, because of this, because of that, because of that, because of that. Today, he's in an exalted position. One of the jobs that anybody will want in Nigeria. Because people are watching what you are doing. People are watching. Some of the product that you will create or company you create, some of the people you are working with today might become your customer tomorrow. But the way you treat their business, the way you treat them, the way you treat the people around them, determines the kind of recommendation you